Hey, you there watching this. You like card games? You like playing your favorite decks? Do you like winning even though you aren't? Well, viewer that should be subscribed, I have the answers to help you make any deck you are playing help to see victory. I've been playing Magic the Gathering and Yu-Gi-Oh! For over 15 years, and along the way, I would like to think that I've gotten good enough at the game to provide some tips and tricks to make a very effective deck. For some of those games, it can be done easily with spending little to no money at all. Such games like Yugioh Duel Links or other freemium card-based games can be applied to even physical card games as well for a very low budget. Choice is yours, so without further ado, let's just jump into the video. So I'm mainly going to break this video into several parts. Choose your deck and its staples, making sure your deck has a clear win condition, making your deck consistent to win with your win condition, considering how your deck functions with other mechanics and its weaknesses, prepare if you don't have your win condition right away, thinking outside the box, and I'm also going to be talking about pay-to-win concept as well, and a conclusion overall. Since the majority of the channel viewers are fans of Duel Links, I'm going to be using that card game as the base for the video to convey visuals, but again, these tips can apply to any card game. First, let's start with the first objective, choose your deck. I know this is pretty straightforward, but it's also the most important one because once you made this choice, it allows you to dive straight into the card support for your deck, and snowball the other steps for this video. For example, with Duel Links, let's go with Elemental Hero Neos, a pure build variant. Neos is a normal monster, however has a lot of fusion support that offers him a wide variety of abilities and tactics to help win the game. Whether it be pure aggression during the battle phase or even using cards like Elemental Hero Aqua Neos to provide a bit of control variant by reducing your opponent's cards in their hand. For me in this video though, I want to focus on providing more of the power aspect and have a slight focus on control for the secondary focus. Now that I have the deck in mind that I want to build, I want to look at the cards I can use to win the game. And again, I'm going to be relying on the extra deck for this due to its explosive potential. I'm going to be relying on cards like Neos Fusion to be able to summon those cards really easily without using cards in our hand. Because if we can use our deck instead, think of it. We control what gets sent to the graveyard. We also get to maintain card advantage in our hand, and maintaining card advantage is a huge in any card game, period. Some other fantastic cards we'll be bringing out Neos Fusion monsters are cards like Miracle Contact. Think of Miracle Contact being a Neos Fusion, however it returns the fusion material cards back into the deck, and it doesn't have the rest of the turn summon restrictions. This is a fantastic card in its own right, however the biggest benefit to sending back to the deck is it allows us to control what we are sending back and reuse some very powerful support cards, which I will go over in the section called Thinking Outside the Box, so stay tuned to the video for that subject. But in terms of Neo support, it allows us to reuse cards like Neo Space Connector, which is a great mid-game card that can set up for contact fusion plays, and several of our other Neospatian monsters such as Neospatian Flame Scarab. I am also going to be running the spell card Polymerization to be able to have a fourth fusion outlet, as well as the ability to allow me to play Neospace in order to prevent my monsters from being sent back to the extra deck, as well as giving my Neos creatures an additional 500 attack points. This can really add up over the course of the game. So to summarize, we are going to be using Elemental Hero Neo Fusions and cards to bring them out as soon as possible, beef them up with Neospace, and overwhelm our opponent with their brute strength and speed. Now that we have an idea of what deck we want to play and some of the powerful cards are going to get us to victory, we need to find a way to make this more consistent. How do we do that? Well, it's simple, or should I say, simply math. In Duel Links, we play with 20 card minimum decks, with an opening hand of 4 cards, and we draw 1 card in our starting hand if we are going second. So if we go second, which is what Neos prefers to do, we are starting our first turn with 5 cards in hand. So if we have multiple copies of the most powerful cards in our deck to get us to our win condition, then our chances of getting those win conditions increase tremendously. Now, most card games have rules and restrictions on how many of certain copies of cards you can play, so be sure to keep that in mind. For example, with Neos Fusion, we are only able to run no more than 2 copies of that card. However, we are playing other cards to be able to help us search out those key cards, or other cards that help us get closer to our win condition. The extra deck Elemental Hero Brave Neos is ultimately one of the best cards in the deck due to the fact that he can search out our Neos Fusions, Miracle Contacts, and even next if we decide to play that card. So in summary, by having several copies of your key cards, or by playing cards that get you closer to those key cards by tutoring them in your hand, you'll be able to make your deck more mathematically consistent every time. The next topic I want to discuss is thinking how your deck functions involving other mechanics within the game. What do I mean by that? I don't really know, but by reading out the script, it goes into details about thinking about how Other decks' play style may be different from your own, and also the mechanics of the game itself. For example, one of the worst things that can happen with this deck is our opponents banishing our graveyard, removing key cards we can't get back, such as Neospace, or getting rid of the ability to use fusion spells altogether. For Neosynthic's example, Neospace is a strong fabric to the deck in the way that I built it, but it's not the end of the world if it's gone. I'm running cards like Power of the Guardian that can provide our Brave Neos with extra strength it needs, at the same time offering protection. The Neos Fusion itself also has synergy and prevents our boss monster's demise or from being sent back to the extra deck by simply banishing it from the graveyard, which can easily save us. Now, if there comes a time where we don't have access to our fusion spells, we still have powerful cards like Neospace Connector in order to summon Neos or a Neospatian from the deck to set up the field, and then we contribute the Space Connector to summon one from the graveyard or hand in place, which can lead to a contact fusion during the mid-game. So by knowing my deck's strengths and weaknesses, I can use this to my advantage and try to think ahead and be smart with my resources. And this is huge, especially if you understand how your opponent's deck works and what their normal go-to plays are. What do you do though if you're not able to get to your win condition right away? Well, at that point, use your deck strength to help get there. For example, let's take a look at our best bud, Brave Neos. When he destroys a monster by battle, he can instantly search out another card with Neos in the card text. So if we end up drawing a Polymerization over a Neos Fusion, by bringing out Brave Neos early on is a great way to search out those cards. Think about it. With Neospace, he'll be roughly around 3,000 attack at least. Not many decks can drop a monster that big on turn 1, easily netting a search when we destroy a monster. Another thing we can take in consideration is using cards that delay our opponent as well. If you follow me on Twitch and watch me stream Duel Links, you'll realize that I often use a card called Drowning Mirror Force. This card is fantastic for resetting the board state to cause both players' field for the monster side of things to be leveled again. And depending on what your opponent has on the field and what they have in their hand, this one card can easily set them back several turns, which allows us time to get either our key cards or even go for the victory right then and there on our turn. I also like cards for this deck like Destructive Wave, because if we can get our Brave Neos out after activating this card against our opponent, it can help us search out our Brave Neos fusion plays once we destroy their weakened monster and provide even more damage to them because their attack will be so much lower. It's such an awesome combo. Next, let's cover one of my personal favorites, which is Thinking Outside the Box. This is where you can use staples to your decks, which is cards that are often universally good or just combo really well for your specific playstyle. We already mentioned two staples in this video being Drowning Mirror Force and Disruptive Blade. Literally any deck can play these two cards and still yield some form of reward. However, let's take a look at two cards that are not in the Neos archetype but work very well. The first card I want to talk about is Keeper of the Dragon Magic. This card is insane for any fusion deck because when you normal summon it, you can discard and search any fusion card like Neos Fusion. The second effect also allows you to reveal a fusion monster and special summon one of the materials face down defense position from your graveyard. That is insane. This one card literally does what the deck wants and so much more, and it searches the most powerful cards of the deck, but also works wonders for other fusion cards like Polymerization by bringing back other cards from the grave to the field, since Brave Neos can be fusion summoned with any level 4 or lower effect monster, meaning we can reuse resources from the grave in our hand or deck when it may not be the most optimal. Another recent card that I've been finding success with is actually a Lunalight card, believe it or not, being Lunalight Crimson Fox. If this card is sent to the graveyard by a card effect, it changes the attack of one monster on the opponent's side of the field to 0. That's amazing for us, because at this point, since our fusion monsters are 3,000 plus attack usually, that can make the next attack potentially lethal if they're at 0. So in summary, don't be afraid to look outside your deck's main archetype or family, because there could be some quite powerful key plays somewhere else. The next two topics that I do want to mention are not my favorite, but they are something to consider. The first one being pay to win. Now, the saying that you get what you pay for can be 100% true. For example, with Duel Links and their structure decks, after buying them with the in-game currency once, you have to purchase them with real cash for the next few purchases. And at times, there will be key cards that will only be available in the deck itself. For our main man, Neos, that is very much true. Brave Neos, Neos Fusion, and Neos Space Connector are all part of the deck. So for me to take the deck to the next level and get it more consistent, I spent the $4 in order to get the second copy of the deck. To me, Neos brought me enough enjoyment for me to justify paying it to make it more consistent by getting those cards. However, this isn't something that always has to be done. In fact, many decks in Duel Links and other card games can be very powerful and consistent with only the in-game currencies, such as, we talked about Lunalights and many more, Cyber Dragons as well. But again, if there are some cards that are locked behind a paywall that you don't want to buy, you can easily find some free greed substitutes, which depend on the overall deck that you're playing. Another thing you can do if you want is simply use the internet to look up deck lists. I usually don't recommend doing this because it may not coexist with your playstyle, and since you didn't build the deck yourself, you may need to spend a good amount of time playing the deck to get a feel for it. But again, it's an option, and sometimes it'd be a great good starting point to be able to see what everybody else may be doing for that specific deck that you want to build. And there you have it! All the things I look into in building my own decks, or suggestions for deck buildings when it comes with Yu-Gi-Oh!, Magic the Gathering, or even the Pokemon TCG card game, any card game in general. These tactics are very universal and can be applied to nearly every card game, and hopefully these tips get you one step closer to building your ultimate deck. Thank you so much for watching, everyone. Be sure to subscribe to the channel if you enjoyed the content, and if you want to watch me stream card games, follow me over on Twitch as well. Link in the description below, and let me know down below in the comment section what you do when you build a deck, and what card games you've been playing, because I'm very curious if there's any gems that I might have missed out in terms of either card games or just decks I'm not familiar with. Take care, everybody. Peace.